Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Ag Innovation News Podcast, presented by the Agricultural Utilization Research Institute of Minnesota. I'm Dan Scogan, Director of Government and Industry Relations for AURI. Guests on the Ag Innovation News Podcast will shed light on innovations in value-added agriculture, highlight important voices and work that's being done throughout the Minnesota ag sector, and educate the public about resources and organizations that support Minnesota agriculture. Now, today we want to welcome to our podcast GreenSeam's Sam Ziegler. GreenSeam's director is Sam Ziegler. He has a passion for all things related to agriculture, being a part of providing food, feed, fuel, and fiber to families in our area and to families abroad, and such an amazing profession to be part of. In this position, Ziegler also works with key ag stakeholders, building coalitions along with developing and executing key strategic initiatives that are essential components to realize the aspirations of GreenSeam. Sam spent nearly 10 years with the Minnesota Soybean Research and Promotion Council and Minnesota Soybean Growers Association. He is a fourth-generation partner and operator of Ziegler Farms, located near Good Thunder, Minnesota. Sam enjoys being a father and a husband, and for fun, he likes to play baseball, hangs out at the lake, and does some hunting. So Sam Ziegler and GreenSeam, welcome to our podcast today.
Hey, thanks for having me on, Dan.
Let's get started with GreenSeam itself, because this is a fairly new organization. Just share a little background on GreenSeam, on what GreenSeam is, and what its catalyst was for its creation. What part of Minnesota do you cover? Where's your region?
Sure. Yeah, I'd be happy to talk about that. So, you know, really, GreenSeam stemmed out of the Great Recession within the community of Mankato, which is in south central Minnesota. The recession, you know, was impacting this globe pretty drastically. But when you looked at the data, Mankato was doing exceeding better than most. And so the conversation started in the community saying, why? And when they did the data and the research reports, it continued to be very clear. It was because if you think about agriculture in 2007 to 2009, during that, you know, period, right, agriculture was doing relatively well. And so everybody stepped back and said, well, are we doing anything for this region or our community that's focusing in food and ag, or is it just here naturally? And that was the answer. It was nobody's putting a direct to diehard work into economic development of a community or of a region in the way of saying we should build upon our, you know, oldest and our most noble profession, and that's in the food and ag space. And it just kept leading to another step in the process, and that was, well, let's bring ag businesses and ag leaders together at a table, and maybe we don't need to do anything. Maybe we should do something. And what it led to is a task force, and that led to forming GreenSeam as an entity that really said, no, we need to focus on food and ag. We need to bring it into the economic development world and realm, and we should be being purposeful about focusing on it and not always trying to be something different. And so from there, more research was done. In fact, Metropolitan Statistical Area, MSA, of Blue Earth Nicollet County, which is the Mankato MSA, had a larger livestock income than Omaha, Nebraska. I mean, most people don't think that would be possible, but it was. The data showed it. And so there was really, yes, we need to create an organization focused on economic development. And it was led by businesses, still is today, as a nonprofit organization. So we really kicked ourselves off June of 2016.
And Sam, you were kind of the face of GreenSeam when I got to know the organization. You were spending time at the legislature then, but really it was a tighter coalition of, I guess, economic developers and business-minded agricultural people in that greater Mankato area that brought GreenSeam together?
Yeah, I mean, it was formed out of this greater Mankato growth. Entity is the one that kind of was the catalyst or kind of the group that pulled the business folks together. But when businesses got at the table, and then ultimately I got invited to participate at the table, we knew it couldn't be about one community. We knew it couldn't be limited to one county. We knew it couldn't be limited to even a handful of counties. Businesses don't operate that way, and surely the entire ag industry doesn't operate that way. This is a pretty global agriculture region if you think about who's here and who we serve and where our products go. And so, you know, with that, it was ultimately decided that we're going to talk about Southern Minnesota, we're going to talk about Northern Iowa, And it was really because when you look at the data and you look at the trade region and the density of these core businesses, that covered all of that work. And it really showed that, you know, we stay out of the major metro, so we're representing rural. To date, to my knowledge, we are the only economic development industry cluster in North America that focuses on rural. And so that kind of led into our boundaries, but I have no problem helping people outside that region because I'd much rather have the business located within a region of us rather than sign they need to be down in Houston or something else, because they'll have a bigger impact if they're closer to us. So we don't set a hard boundary.
And that's a great overview, I think, of what Green Seam is, Sam. Tell us who you serve.
Our core is we want to help businesses, you know, and we want to help them. We want to keep them here if they're already here. We want to help new ones with new ideas. But ultimately, if the businesses are successful and the businesses are growing and they're doing well, the communities do well. And so ultimately, we're about community resiliency, which definitely, if local communities are doing well, our state will do well. But at the core, it's how do we help these businesses, these business owners succeed? And a lot of it has to do with who's already here, because in the world of numbers, 85% of growth from a community or a region is from businesses that already exist. And so sometimes we overlook who's already here. We're chasing the next new business that might come in or might grow, but can't forget who is already here. So that's really who we serve. Ultimately, it's our state, or it's Iowa, but it's this region, it's our community. But the root of it is our businesses have to do well. Otherwise, there's no reason for the region to do well.
I go to your website and I see that Green Seam's mission is to bolster the growth of the food and ag industry by strategically attracting, building, and empowering new and existing businesses, their workforce, and their communities that they call home. So put a little more meat on the bone there, Sam. Tell me a little more about how Green Seam accomplishes your mission.
We really are after the elevation of our region as a world-class food and ag business, sir. Okay. And to do that, we want to shape the future of the business. We want to shape the future of agriculture and communities in the region. You know, a lot of this that we're doing, and it's in our name of Green Seam. Seam is references to a couple different things. It references to the rich valley of soil that we have here and you know, that was God given to us, right? We have to take care of it, but that's the seam of soil that helps us. But also seam represents a seam, you can say, in clothing, right? Without the stitching, it doesn't do any good. And so we need to work with others and work with others more, you know, closely on these projects. This isn't, Green Seam won't solve all of our challenges. We need solid partners like AURI. We need the communities to be a solid partner, and we also need those businesses to be there. So we work really closely with a lot of people to help out somebody grow and somebody succeed. We also do this by telling the story. And what that means is if we don't tell our own story and we're Minnesota nice, Minnesota humble, nobody else is going to tell it for us. Kentucky, Singapore, whatever you want to say, right? They're not going to tell the story of all the great companies that we have here. And so we've put effort into how do we highlight these companies, these stories with branding, with working with our state, working with our local media outlets to make sure that they understand who's here, because a lot of the companies we have aren't going to find on the shelf of Target or Walmart because they're helping somebody make that product. They're not the ones that are ultimately with the end product. And so that's one way. Another way that we've really tried to take and not just tout a message or a mission, but to actually live it is we got to provide information, data, and a different way of explaining what food and ag is. And the way we explain it is we're an industry cluster. A cluster represents a concentration of these ag businesses. Well, if you look at most data, it'll call agriculture out in the data. And in today's world, it often looks small. Well, that's because how the data is collected is looking at farmers. Well, yeah, we are, you know, less than 2% of the U.S. population is the ones that are producing all the food. So the numbers don't show up big. But when you start looking at, well, who starts with economy? The economy starts with natural resources, food and ag, mining, timber, that type of stuff. Well, in our area, it's food and ag. And then you start going to the second sectors of the economy, which is manufacturing. And then you have professional services and stuff in the third sector. All those are super well-developed and strong in food and ag, all the way through the fifth sector, which is government and research. Look around the world and tell me that they have all five sectors of an economy really working well. And we're pretty fortunate. And so that data can come out when we look at it that way. Most community banks are 65%+ invested in food and ag companies. Well, they're a bank. Well, that's not ag. Well, who are they lending to? So how do we take that data, look at it differently, and share that data and get people to understand the root of our success? I guess punt intended, right? So then it's turning around and saying, we need to focus on this food and ag thing, not just take it for granted, which most people are like, well, there's another cornfield. I'm going to drive by it, you know, but they don't realize the economic engine that is and how many products that corn can turn into thanks to ARI and others that dive into that chemistry. And so that's some of generally how we talk about and how we try to raise the tide, raise the momentum and focus in on what we are truly excelling at that sometimes has been overlooked because it's why people settled here, right? And so it's been here forever.
And Sam, you know, when I've been at some of your events, the other clear message I get from you is that you really believe in engaging our educational system so that the next generation of consumers, the next generation that build economic development, and the next generation of farmers truly understand where our food and ag comes from.
You know, even when I first joined on this group and was brought on as the first staff person, the kind of the founding, you know, founder person, talent was a part of the discussion. I didn't know anything about talent as far as education system. And so then it was as we dove into it and we started looking at what companies were facing and what some of the biggest challenges are, whether it is on the side that, you know, you spend a lot of time in on the policy side of who's making decisions that are impacting this 2% of population based upon a pencil on a paper that's 1,000 miles from a field. And then the next section of that education is we want the smartest people to be staying here in food and ag. The smartest people don't need to leave. There's plenty of opportunity here. And so as we dove into that now today, fast forwarding to today, where you can't have a conversation with a business or about economic development and not talk about talent or the shortage or the lack of. It's just impossible. And so I give a lot of credit to those that helped form this organization, and putting that is a key thing. I mean, we started as an official organization in 2016, but this work, you know, started in 2010 to 2015 was stuff being done on it. And education and talent were a key component of that since the beginning of it.
When you think about some of the Green Seam partners and clients that come to you looking for services, what are the more common services or resources that Green Seam can provide?
You know, these folks that need help, they're experts in their field. And often they're lacking the connection to the right person that could help them be more successful. They might not build a new facility every year. They might not be connected with programs that are out there. And if you're an ag, often you don't realize the programs that can affect or can be a part of food and ag, but aren't in that ag bucket and talked about every day. So connections are absolutely one of the top of what's your challenge? What are you looking for? I most likely am not going to be the expert, but I will figure it out. And I'll make sure that you get connected to somebody that's willing to spend some time with them and help them get to that next level of in their business, whether it's a startup or whether it's a business that's been here for 50 years. Guidance is another one of those of often there's a lot of ideas that come and there's a lot of things that somebody wants to accomplish, and how do they focus and get them to drill in maybe what's most important and ask the hard questions. And so create this space where I can give honest, safe feedback. I can give it very directly and very clearly, and my team can, and get them to dive into what they need to before they appear in front of a panel to give a pitch to receive investment. Give them that feedback before they write that grant they're looking for, or before they start a marketing campaign that, you know, we ask them some tough questions. Some of the other parts that we have there are, you know, around talent. I mean, you brought it up a little bit ago, you know, but in specific programs, it's, you know, we're getting programs started at high schools. We're getting programs started at colleges that haven't existed for 25 years, or in some cases, they've never had a program around food and ag. And those are then allowing businesses to be in front of a wider audience of students. They're allowing students to say, well, I never thought about looking at that company because I thought they were small and just ag. No, they're a high tech international company located here in a, you know, small strip mall and nobody knows about them, but apply that work there. So spend a lot of time with the talent. We're doing a lot right now on international and global workforce. And how do we provide the key connections and resources to a business that says that the talent, it's not here. There's not enough. There's not the right people. Well, there's other options that aren't being tapped to its full capacity. And my last point on this, Dan, is we have business competitors, strong competitors on our board, on our committees, working together on this shared vision. And ultimately saying, you know what, I might not be able to help this person, but talk with Sam, one of my competitors might. That's rare. It's very rare in the world, and especially a small world of food and ag, but we're somehow magically pulling it off because everybody's getting behind this with the expectations of what the vision is, and we have to work together.
Very good. I want to remind our listeners that you're listening to the Ag Innovation News Podcast, presented by the Agricultural Utilization Research Institute of Minnesota. Our guest today is Director Sam Ziegler. Sam is the director of GreenSeam, and we're finding out more about that organization and what it does for Minnesota agriculture. Sam, I'm going to go there next. I guess the million-dollar question, how does GreenSeam support Minnesota Ag?
At the most base form, it's economic development. We're peer simply an economic development organization with the focus on food and ag. And so if you think about Minnesota agriculture, and while often people are like, well, farmers are less than 2%, you know, in Minnesota as a whole, we're probably a little bit more than 2%, but we're 25% of the state's GDP. Or I say we, agriculture as a whole is. And we're diving into that. And that's our core. You know, in other sorts of way, I mean, we're pulling data together with the Minnesota State of Agriculture report, which is a platform built around panels of individuals, you know, in a room having a conversation about what is happening. Let's be honest and feedback. And then we follow that up with a survey. And the survey is really to dive in and make data out of what we anecdotally continue to hear. And it's turned into, started out as just a, you know, GreenSeam region, specifically a southern Minnesota, a little bit northern Iowa. And the last 2 years now, it's been a full state effort and survey with ag organizations, Department of Ag and the Minnesota Chamber, others sharing the survey link so people can join in on it. And that data then is being used for our legislators. They can say, well, what's the pulse happening? And when I say the pulse of agriculture, it includes this whole ecosystem. So we're asking educators to provide input back. We're asking the professional services, the large manufacturers, the local farms. I mean, we're asking them all what they think of these different questions. And then that's able to go back into this overall report and give people a direction of, no, this is where it is. And as we get past the, you know, we're past year three now, it's just going to continue to have better and stronger data looking at the ability to look back and say, are we making progress or are we not? And so those are the things that works that way. Also, when it comes to foreign direct investment, or when it comes into how does our state leaders talk to folks about really what is ag and what does it all encompass and how do we attract new companies here? We're the entity now the state says, hey, you know, you need to talk to GreenSeam and work with foreign companies that might look at expanding. And so we're helping out Minnesota in all kinds of way, but we're one more voice in a small group of people that have the voice for food and ag in a big pond. And so we're trying to do what we can do.
It does have to feel good though, when you realize that others are pointing to you for direction, and it's kind of like we finally made it, or we're being recognized for what we know.
It is. It's huge. I just this last week, I got an email from an organization in Michigan saying, hey, I've been following what you're doing in Minnesota. Would you be so kind and willing to share what you're doing? We don't have any secrets. I mean, we're trying to be innovative. We're trying to create new things, but there is no silver bullet out there. I mean, we're trying to shoot silver buckshot, if you can follow that analogy. But we're getting those continually now, and that does make it finally get to the point of what we're trying to accomplish, and it does feel good. But then you got to put your head back down to the grindstone and get back to work too.
I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about value-added agriculture a little bit, Sam. Does GreenSeam work in that area at all? And if so, what role does the organization play in value-added agriculture?
Well, in some cases, we're just supporting AURI here and making sure the companies find you guys when it comes to really taking a Minnesota commodity, a product, and figuring out how to do something, you know, in the laboratory or in processing to really change that. But there are other areas that we're working on that there was a gap. Nobody really here in the state that did it really well of what if a company has an idea around technology or chemistry for fertilizers or doing those types of things, and how do you help them find success and the right partners? And so we've spent a lot of time helping technology type startups that see Minnesota as a great place to start their business, or they're here already, and help them connect, you know, with the resources that they need. And so often we're spending time outside of the world of what most people see as ag, but in other sectors that work with business plans, work with marketing plans, some grant dollars for high tech startups. That doesn't have to be ag. It can be medical, it can be whatever, but it applies to ag as well. So you spend time in there. The other side, what I see of value added, that, you know, you can define it a little bit differently, is was proud to just be recently part of a brand new feed mill that started up. We helped direct them to some places where there was some funding that had low interest loans through USDA. We directed them into some other avenues, and ultimately it created a $22 million feed mill, which a feed mill is a value added component of our system. Did the same thing in vegetable processing and worked with the community on the vegetable processing facility, which was ultimately well over a $200 million project. So that'll be here for another 50 years, and they're adding value to be able to continue to process those vegetables, those peas and sweet corn. And so those are the types of things that maybe we've jumped into a little harder, besides the fact that Minnesota Department of Agriculture has an awesome value-added grant program. And we put a lot of support and effort into that. Again, what you guys are doing at AURI and the foodie market. You know, if people are interested in that next foodie thing, you know, Grow North is a great resource as well. And so a lot of connections in there, but then we'll fill in the gaps on the other side.
There is an image on your website that connects GreenSeam to Silicon Valley. Tell me about that a little bit.
So if you could picture yourself thinking about Silicon Valley, most people know it, a high percentage of people know it. They know that it stands for a center of solutions when it comes to technology, and often are magnetized to go there. What people often don't know is they can't even name three towns in the Silicon Valley. Well, Silicon Valley is a region of, you know, depending on who you look at, three to six or seven million people. Here we are in rural Minnesota, or Minnesota as a whole. I mean, Minnesota's population as a whole is, what, 6 million. How are people ever going to remember where, you know, these towns are, Fairmont, Jackson, Owatonna, and whatnot, when they're, you know, they're small towns? But yet this region, as an industry cluster that the data clearly shows that we are, and we can talk about location quotients and all those kinds of things if you want to, but it clearly shows that we are this industry cluster, which means that we are a powerhouse in food and ag, which means we are this really, really strong area. And so the branding of GreenSeam to be knowing as this solution center when it comes to food and ag, people don't have to know exactly what town does it represent. They don't have to know all the details of the region, but they just need to know that we are a Silicon Valley of ag, meaning we have technology. We've had it for years. We're a global leader when it comes to this stuff. And we are the solution center, ultimately, that if you need to solve a challenge in food and ag or create a new product or market, is you should be located in the GreenSeam. And we want you here. And we have the resources here. We have the experts that can dive into any specific, you know, field or sector within it. And so when we really compare billions of dollars of economic impact in our region, we are this solution center. And so, yeah, we say we want people to recognize us as this center just as much as somebody's going to recognize Silicon Valley or recognize Wall Street, or you can think of some other industry type clusters. So ultimately, the long haul is people are like, yeah, we got to go there. We got to set up shop there. That's the place to be.
When you look at the next 3 to 5 years, Sam, what are some of the goals for Green Seam?
Touched a little bit on, the success of people outside of our region, thousands of miles from here, reaching out to saying, what's in your water? What's going on here? You guys are kicking butt. We keep hearing about you guys. Your region's growing. Your communities are not shrinking. Rural communities aren't shrinking like maybe they did in the early 2000s or even late 2000s. They're growing. And so that's ultimately our goal. To get there, we need to figure out how to partner with folks that work in policy, because we need some policy things changed to be a little more business friendly. It's the number one issue coming out of the State of Ag report is not necessarily even the regulation, the time in which it takes to get through the process. We can meet the regulations. Let's just be honest. So we need to make some things smoother, and we're not going to solve them by ourselves, but we can help point out the challenges to it. The other goals and components is this: the workforce is one of the weakest links, no matter where you're looking at in the U.S. And so if we can be at the table and grow and create and attract the best of the best and create this place where our future generations say, yeah, I don't need to be a farmer, or I don't need to be the chemistry, but I can figure out how this ag industry works, and I can be, trading commodities, or they can be that chemistry expert or data mining individual, right? So the talent is going to be huge in the future to be able to sustain our businesses that we have and then grow them. So I want to spend a lot of time on the talent front, and that is the global workforce conversation, all the way to, what's that kindergartner thinking? What do they want to be when they grow up? And how do we create that pipeline? They can know what opportunity there is in ag, even if they didn't grow up on a farm. And then it's globally, we need to be known as this powerhouse solution center, and people to be coming here and setting up a food and ag business rather than thinking that they're a tech company and need to set up in Silicon Valley. Well, our customers, the work is here. So let's have the tech company set up here because it's food and ag.
Somebody might be listening today that's wondering if they're a good fit for Green Seam. And when you think back on some of your success stories over the last 6-7 years, Sam, what kind of collaborations seem best suited for Green Seam? What are you looking for?
Oh, man. Some of those folks might not even see agriculture as what they think they are interested in. If you think about wellness as a big topic right now, health and wellness, right? Well, ag is a huge part of that. You got to eat, right? And so I think there's a lot of people that are crossover between health and food and ag extremely well. Whether you think about the DNA and genomics, it's no different if you look at a plant versus a human in many regards. And so that connection's there. But then data is able to guide businesses and folks forward, and data is power. And there's more sensors today and more data being collected on every single stage in the process that we have within food and ag, but all of it's not being used to its full potential by no means. And as we continue to add more sensors and get more data, how can we help be a solution for it? So I think folks that are listening, it can be anybody. If you're really passionate with a brand new idea, it's just written on the napkin and thrown in your, book bag, you'd be a great connection. If you're a really strong global food company that are listening to this and saying, what can be done? Well, the talent stuff we're working in, it can maybe help connect you to some interesting places. But on the other side of things, it's maybe they have a new idea and trying to figure out where it best fits and where's the right location within the Green Seam to put up a new company. And we'd be happy to be that intermediary to get some site selections presented back to us. And then we can present them to you. And then you know, the whole town doesn't have to be talking about, you know, who is the one looking for a new building or another 40 acres to expand their business. And so we help all of that area. And if you're looking for folks to connect with youth or connect and be a supporter and give back, that maybe you're at the tail end of your career and you're like, you know, I just want to help others, you know, be successful. We're always looking for that expert in certain fields that could be the connection that I make with that business that's struggling, you know, at a stage of their game, and connect you folks together, and boom, you could be part of something that's pretty cool.
Getting close to the end of our conversation, Sam, are there any Green Seam programs or events coming up that you'd like our listeners to know about?
Our signature event each year is called the Rural Forum. It's a place where we have dialogues with influential and folks that have made some major impacts over the years about food and ag and rural areas, and even have some policy conversation a part of that. And that is December 1st.
And more information at your webpage. That was going to be my last question. You gave the web address, but let's give it one more time for people who are looking for Green Seam.
Yeah, so it's greenseam.org. And when you think of green, it's the color green, and seam is S-E-A-M.
Sam Ziegler, director at Green Seam, thanks for your time today.
This was awesome. Appreciate being a guest in this program, and look forward to hearing from listeners that get a chance to listen to this awesome program.
We've been visiting with Sam Ziegler, director at Green Seam. I want to thank Sam for joining us today, and thank you for listening to the Ag Innovation News Podcast, presented by the Agricultural Utilization Research Institute of Minnesota. Thanks to our podcast crew, Eric Evans, the AURI Director of Communications, and Lisa Martinez, AURI Communications Coordinator and Editor of this production. To learn more about AURI, go to auri.org.